He's up there, hop on the beat.
On May 19th, 2021, JoJolion reached its 107th chapter and its 10th anniversary of beginning publication. Part 8 has become the longest-running part in JoJo, surpassing Steel Ball Run 7 years. And that's not just because of the monthly release. The actual page count of JoJolion easily places it as the longest part in the series. Along with this, JoJolion has the most intricately crafted plot in the series so far. As a result, there have been a large number of subplots and plot elements introduced over these 10 years, and they have slowly started coming back into the spotlight. So in this video, I'd like to take a look back at JoJolion's 10-year history and talk about everything that has yet to be followed up on. The first and one of the most integral plot elements of JoJolion is the Walleyes. These are a phenomenon that emerged out of Morio after the 2011 earthquake. They take the form of large protrusions that face out towards the sea as if to protect from something. One of the properties of the Walleyes is that when two things are buried in them, they undergo an equivalent exchange. The most well-known example of this is the main character Josuke, who is a combination of two different people buried in the Walleyes. The other power of the Walleyes is the ability to grant stands to those who come near it. This power has existed as part of Morio's soil long before the earthquake. Those who lived near future locations of the Walleyes were still affected by its power when it was underground. This is how many people in Morio became stand users. The Higashikata family has known about the power of the Walleyes for a long time, and have used it for generations to cure their family's disease by exchanging it to another person. The exact origin of the Walleyes is unknown, but it is most likely related to the incident involving Johnny Joestar and the Saint's corpse. Johnny brought the corpse from America to cure his wife's disease. For a short time, he hid the corpse underneath the Twin Pines of Morio. This later became the location that the Higashikatas used to cure the disease, and also one of the most prominent locations of the Walleyes. The Walleyes have also been shown to be connected to the Devil's Palms, another stand-granting phenomenon created by the Saint's corpse. The Walleyes and Devil's Palms are both what the Rock Cubans consider to be blessings from the Earth, which they claim as their safe places and gain powers from. The Rock Cuban Dolomite lived in the area surrounding the Mutsukabe Shrine, which was apparently unaffected by the earthquake. The same is true for the Higashikata residents, which seems to have been protected by the Walleyes. The true nature of the Walleyes and its relationship with rock humans is sure to be elaborated on in the future. The next plot element to discuss are the bite marks. These seemingly human-shaped bite marks appeared on Josuke, Yasuho, and Joshu shortly after they visited the Walleyes. The bite marks appeared semi-frequently for the first couple dozen chapters of the part and have since healed. Josuke's bite mark appeared once again in a flashback had by Yasuho in Chapter 71. The origin and effects of these bite marks are still unknown at this point, but they are definitely related to the Walleyes. One theory had by some was that the bite marks are an indication of being granted a stand by the Walleyes. This is currently unclear. Josuke's two previous identities obviously already had stands, which combined to create his. Yasuho was also shown to have unknowingly already possessed Paisley Park as a child, likely having already gotten it from being near the Walleyes. Joshu seemingly first awakened his stand during the Shakedown Road arc, but it is unknown whether this is really the result of the bite mark. During his fight with Ojiro, Josuke has a brief vision in which he sees a man with long hair in front of the Walleyes. He believes that this is one of his missing memories. This is one of the most commonly discussed plot points from early JoJolion, and it has yet to make a return. Many have tried to say that this character is an early design for another that we've already seen. I find this extremely unlikely. First of all, Josuke has never recognized another character as one from his flashback. Probably the most common candidate people name for this character is Tamaki Damo, despite there being no precedent in the series for such an extreme design change. Secondly, Damo was never encountered in front of the Walleyes like this. Some have even tried to say that this is an early design for Ojiro, despite Ojiro appearing at the end of the very same chapter. Others have also said that it's an early design for Kira, despite Kira being first shown in the next chapter. Also, it would make no sense at all for Josuke to be seeing Kira. The main thing to address here is whose memory this is supposed to be. Many have believed that this is one of Kira's memories, since the subject is wearing the sailor outfit. However, Kira was never shown wearing his hat in the style that Josuke does. Since Kira's design first appeared in the next chapter, and it was clearly thought out at this point, it's doubtful that this was meant to be Kira's memory. Also, since Josuke has no other memories at all of either of his previous halves, it would be very strange for him to remember this specific thing. So I believe that this is not a memory of Kira, but rather of Josuke. If I had to guess, I'd say this is something that happened after the fusion, but prior to his meeting with Yasuho. However, another equally likely scenario is that this isn't a memory at all, but rather a premonition of the future. With the amount about this that we know, it's really impossible to draw any real conclusions. Regardless, I believe the man in the vision is another distinct character who has yet to be fully introduced, rather than an early design. Shortly after Josuke arrives at the Higashikata residence, he discovers a symbol carved into a stair rail. This same symbol was written on the arm of Yoshikage Kira's corpse, the leftover body of Josuke's fusion. Yasuho later remembered that the mark was present in many locations of the house, as far back as when she was a child. The mark was later revealed to be the emblem of a book publisher, which is present on the Steel Ball Run Race Complete Record by Norisuke Higashikata I. It was known that Kira snuck into the house to alter the family tree in this book to hide his sister's name. This explains why he had the mark written on his arm. As Yasuho said, it was done so that he would remember which mark it was. The reason that it was present on the stair rail and in other locations when Yasuho was a child is unknown. Barring any further revelations, I would guess that the mark was simply doodled there by the Higashikata children who had seen it on the book. The Higashikata family has been shown to have a curse which inflicts the firstborn of each generation with a disease. The disease causes them to turn to stone after reaching a certain age. The disease has also been known to affect the victim's memories. For males, it always happens when they turn 11, but for females it happens later. If left untreated, the victim will die. At some point, the family started using the power of the walleyes to move the disease to other family members to save the firstborn. The origin of this curse is unknown. The fact that the disease turns the victim to stone may indicate that its origin is connected in some way to the rock humans or the Lokakaka. Curses have been talked about frequently throughout the part, ever since the first chapter. They are described as a lingering evil created by a sin that was committed in the past. We saw another curse in the form of the Milagro Man, a rogue stand that was seemingly created after a murder-suicide. It's possible that the Higashikata curse is similar to this in some way. In a previous video, I discussed the connections between the supernatural elements of Steel Ball Run and Jojolian. There I mentioned that it's possible that curses are similar to the miracles caused by saints, only with a negative connotation. The rock disease is coming into focus again with Tsurugi's exchange with Toru, so we will likely get some form of explanation soon. Kira's mother, Holly, is one of the most important characters in the story, serving as Josuke's main motivation. She has been shown to be able to see stands, since she notices Paisley Park after meeting Yasuho. She was also definitely aware of stand abilities, since she asks Kira to use his stand to save Josafumi. This would indicate that Holly is a stand user, however we have yet to actually see what her stand is. It will hopefully be shown off at some point in the future. When Yasuho was first discovering her stand power, it led her into finding an article about Johnny Joestar's past history in Morio. This led to her finding another article about an event which took place on the same day as Johnny's death. A baby boy was found washed up on the beaches of Morio nearby the Twin Pines. He was wearing nothing but a wool cap and also had valuable jewelry around his neck. Nothing else has been said about this baby in the story. I honestly have no clue where this plot point could be going. However, there is no doubt whatsoever that it is connected with Johnny's actions at the Twin Pines. If you asked me about this years ago, I would have said that the baby is probably a rock human. However, with what we've learned about rock human biology since then, this seems to no longer be a possibility. On the Higashikata property, there is a separate building with a basement underneath. This was first visited by Yasuho when Tsurugi brings her there. It was said that the building is used for the curing of Higashikata family members. Yasuho remarks that the building seems like a prison. Later, Tsurugi says he recognizes Josuke from a room in the basement. We also see one of Kira's sailor outfits in the room, indicating that he may have stayed there. Norisuke says that Yatsuyu also used the room when he was designing the main building. A vent in the room also became connected to one of the Morio Pines after the earthquake. This is one of the more interesting plot points since it deals with an unseen period of Kira's history. We know that Kira and Norisuke were working together in some way. According to Norisuke, he was aware that Kira was looking for a cure to the rock disease. I find it likely that Kira was somewhat manipulating Norisuke to investigate the Higashikata family, since he had learned the fruit parlor was involved in the smuggling of rock humans. I find it likely that Kira stayed in the room during this, at whatever time that may have been. Kira first discovered the rock humans in 2009, and he stole the branch with Josafumi in 2010. It wasn't until August 2011 when they were buried in the walleyes. So that leaves many gaps in which Kira could have started interacting with Norisuke. I find it likely that this happened before the branches were stolen, and also around the same time that Kei infiltrated the family as the maid. This is also when Kira would have altered the family tree to hide her name. I tend to believe this happened earlier rather than later, since it would be strange for Kira to be seemingly looking for a cure with Norisuke when he already had the fruit growing. But as I said, Kira may have just been stringing Norisuke along so he could investigate the fruit parlor. The Lokakaka is one of the main sought-after items in the story. It is a fruit capable of performing an equivalent exchange, repairing one body part while turning another to stone. Later, the fruit grafted onto a tree above the walleyes created the new Lokakaka, which can perform an exchange between two people. If the new Lokakaka becomes ripe, it will apparently have a new power, supposedly one powerful enough to eliminate the Higashikata curse. We know very little about the origin of the fruit. It seems to originate from the island of New Guinea, with it being known about as early as the 1930s. The fact that it performs an exchange likely means that its origin is connected to the saint's corpse in some way. The rock humans are the primary antagonists of the part. They are a race of silicon-based beings that hide within human society. According to Urban Gorilla, the ultimate goal of the rock humans is to move above humans in society and become the dominant species. He seems to believe that the fully ripened new Lokakaka is going to cause this. We currently do not fully grasp the rock humans' motives or their origin. Since the rock humans are so closely linked with the fruit, the disease, and the power of exchange, I find it likely that whatever their origin is, it is connected to these in some way. Josuke eventually meets Karera Sakunami, a former acquaintance of Josafumi. She helps him learn about his past identity before disappearing, saying that she will return later. She seems to be interested in getting one of the fruit for herself. We will likely see her trying to do this at some point in the future. When Josuke is shown a photo of Josafumi and Kira, Josafumi is seen to have a Joestar birthmark. It is unknown what exactly his relation to the Joestars is, but there are many possibilities since the family tree seen in the book is incomplete. We may eventually get the exact nature of this ancestry in the future. At one point, we are shown a flashback of Yasuho at age 13, when she was attacked by a parasitic rock organism disguised as a hair clip. It was destroyed by Kira, and she kept its remains in a box in her room. Before the fight with poor Tom, it was said that she was going to have an analysis done on the remains to help find the identity of the rock humans. However, the next time we saw Yasuho, she had gone to the hospital. Whether she already did the analysis and will use the results later, or has yet to do it at all, is unknown. It's likely that whatever does come of this, it will tie in with whatever we learn about the origin of the rock humans. One of the biggest upcoming plot points is the Chapter 83 flash forward. We were shown this at the beginning of the Wonder of You arc. We are shown that 13 minutes before the harvest, Joshu, Hato, and Daya are acting as if nothing is happening. Meanwhile, Norisuke is in a body bag upstairs, with Tsurugi planning to do something with the body. Back when this was first shown, it was a shocking turn of events. We eventually saw how Norisuke got to the state he's in. But with the new information we've gotten, the flash forward appears even more complicated. At the current place in the story, the family is definitely aware of what's going on, and part of the house has been destroyed by the calamity. Tsurugi is also under the effects of the rock disease, so at some point within the next couple hours of time in the story, Tsurugi will be seemingly cured, the house will be repaired, the siblings' memories will be changed, and Joshu's arm will be regrown. Also, Jobin, Mitsuba, Kato, and Yasuho will be nowhere to be seen despite being present at the house. The flash-forward narration seems to hint at an evolution for Tsurugi's stand, which may be the cause of this scenario. In the most recent chapter, Tsurugi and Toru start to undergo an exchange with the new Lokakaka. This is most likely what will bring Tsurugi to his seemingly cured state, but there are still a lot of questions surrounding this scene. And that was every currently unresolved plot thread in JoJolion's first 10 years. I think there's no doubt in anyone's mind that JoJolion's plot is one of the most interwoven that Araki has created. On almost a monthly basis, my entire understanding of the part is changed through the revelations of the story. This makes standalone videos on the part difficult, since what we know keeps shifting. But I think that currently, at the 10-year anniversary, and at the end of one of the series' longest arcs, is a good time to pause and look back at what the part has been setting up. I've also recently returned to my chapter reviews of JoJolion, and I am aiming to continue to do them on a monthly basis. If you want to hear me go more in-depth than I normally do on JoJolion, definitely check out my most recent review of Chapter 107. And stay tuned for my future chapter reviews where we'll see even more of these plot points resolved. If you want to be updated on new videos or leave suggestions, join the Hamon Beat Discord using the link in the description. You can also support the channel on Patreon to receive rewards like Discord perks and some uncut videos. And finally, for future videos, subscribe to the channel. Thank you for watching. This is the part of the video where I thank my $5 and up patrons. Thank you to the Owl God, Alex Ramirez, Raziana, Anasui Hat, Doorbell, Cloudy, Monkman, Ashton Joseph Miller, Crayon, Jesper Jansen, Austin Nino, Rigo Vids, Zucato, Joyless Child, Shane Giger, Walter White, and Spider-Gwen Fanfic.